What's up, everybody? This is Brian Mazik of Franchise Play Sports, as well as BleacherReport.com. I got a chance to sit down and talk with Matt Pryor, the lead producer for FIFA World Cup 2014. Drops on April 15th, which is this Tuesday, probably today if you're listening to this now. So let's go ahead and jump into that interview. We talk about almost every aspect of the game. Here's something that you maybe be able to learn a little bit about the game, as well as the direction for the FIFA series moving forward.
Sounds good.
All righty. So let's go ahead and get started, Matt. I got some questions lined up for you. So been playing the FIFA World Cup, 2014 World Cup demo a lot. So differentiating between the normal FIFA experience is important, I think. Yep. So can you talk about what was done to make the FIFA World Cup experience different?
Yeah, absolutely. So there's a number of things. So, I mean, first and foremost, obviously gameplay is a key area, because if someone's coming to us from FIFA 14, they want to feel a difference, because obviously we, at time of launch, would be the best football game EA's ever made, because obviously we've taken FIFA 14 and done a lot more features and a lot more development on that original engine. So that was a key area for us. So what you'll notice is it should feel a lot tighter, a lot more responsive. So some of this was actually driven by consumer feedback on FIFA 14 as well. So we've got features like response dribbling, explosive player movement, and basically what they are is it should feel a lot more tighter and responsive. So some of the feedback on FIFA 14 was that it occasionally feels a little bit laggy, in that you'd obviously make a movement on the gamepad, and that wouldn't, there was a sense of lag between what you did and what it appearing in the game. So we really tightened that up, so players will accelerate faster, decelerate faster, turn faster. So consequently, it should feel a lot more responsive. Similarly with dribbling, we've redone the entire close dribbling control, so now you know we've got all new animations in that, so it will feel tighter, more responsive. Throughout the game we've got over 100 new animations, and they really change it in various aspects, because they're literally throughout the game in various different elements. So a few examples, we've got like new ways to take the ball down, so you can kind of side foot take down. We've got this thing called the samurai kick, which if you've seen our demo video, you kind of see it being performed there. Mm-hmm. We've got over the back headers, which is a common sign in football, and that's simply like the defender or attacker jumping over the back of the opposition. Often see it at goal kicks, corner kicks, that kind of thing. We've now got that in, so that really kind of changes things up. So all these 100 animations really kind of change things up, because it gives you a new way to trap the ball, new way to take the ball, and consequently that kind of filters throughout gameplay. We've then got pinpoint passing again.
Yes.
That's another feature that really kind of makes the game a lot more responsive and a lot quicker. It's easier now to get the ball to your teammate, and that results in kind of more fluid, faster gaming and games, and ultimately more exciting. And that's kind of the overall direction in many ways to the gameplay, because obviously World Cup is the pinnacle, it's the best of the best, so we wanted the gameplay to reflect that somewhat. So you will notice difference, particularly if you played FIFA 14 recently. We noticed all the feedback is you'll notice the bigger differences, however more frequently you played FIFA 14, because obviously it's a football game at the end of the day, and if you haven't played FIFA 14 for like 5 months, you might not feel the differences as much as if you're coming straight from FIFA 14. And thankfully, all the feedback we've got so far has been positive, in that it is a very different experience to FIFA 14, which is one of the core elements we wanted to get across. And then we've got new features on top of that. So we've got set piece tactics, which is an all new feature at corner kicks, which now allows you to pick you basically dictate what your teammates do. So it doesn't take the penalty kick for you. It's still down to your skill and control as to exactly where to put that. But what you now can do is control your where your teammates run by picking a tactic. So, for example, far post. So your other teammates will kind of drift towards the far post. Similarly, near post. Edge of the area, you can kind of loft it to the edge of the area and go for the kind of Paul Scholes volley from the 18-yard box. And then also crowd the keeper is another one. So your attackers will actually kind of get in the face of the opposing goalkeeper and try and crowd him out. Mm-hmm. So that really adds a level of tactics that we've never had at corner kicks before. Previously, it's just been kind of loft it into the penalty area and hope. Now we've got these tactics, and you don't have to use them. We don't force you. You can still take corners the old way. But it does give you a lot more control and flexibility at corners. And then penalty kicks. We've got all new penalty kick system because we know, and particularly me as an English fan, know to my peril, the importance of penalty kicks at the World Cup.
Oh yeah,
games are often decided on penalty kicks. The World Cup itself has been won on penalty kicks before, so consequently they take up on much more relevance than they do in a regular game, because obviously once you're in the knockout stages, if it ends as a draw, it will go to penalties, whereas regular football it will just end as a draw. So we've redone those and trying to capture some of the drama and excitement of what makes that so special. So we've got all new keeper AI there. There's a lot more intelligence to the keeper. He's got a lot more post-dive intelligence. So previously, if you kind of chose bottom left to dive the keeper, he would kind of launch into his animation, and he'd kind of be stuck in that animation. You didn't really have much intelligence once you've chosen that. So now what we've done is we've got post-dive intelligence. So if he dived into the bottom corner, but the ball just went above him, previously would have just kind of locked in his Superman dive and ignored it. Now we will actually try and reach up and do a post-secondary save. So he's got a lot more intelligence once the ball's been kicked. He's also got a lot more to do before the ball's been kicked. So we've now put in the antics, so goalkeeper antics. You'll often see this in the modern game, the keeper doing something on the line to try and put the kick taker off. So, you know, so now you can replicate that by using the face button. So, you know, you can bounce up and down on the line and wave your arms, make yourself try and look big. You can do that Toro Toro, where he kind of does the bullfighting thing with the cape, kind of encouraging him to score. He'll point into certain areas of the goal to try and, you know, psych him out, saying, try and put it there, kind of thing. And then there's I don't know if you know, the kind of infamous Bruce Grobbelaar wobbly legs that he did in the European Cup.
Right.
He kind of does this kind of crazy... That's right, exactly. So that's just an extra element, and that really kind of exemplifies what the penalty kicks are all about. It is literally kind of a battle of wills, a mind game, if you like, because the actual physical act of taking a penalty kick is relatively simple, but the reason so many professional footballers miss it is because of the pressure, the drama, and all that kind of thing. So we've added an element of that through the brand new penalty kick system.
Yeah.
And that's just gameplay. So over and above that, we've got all the game mode stuff as well, which really differentiates us from FIFA, because we've got experiences and modes that you just can't get in FIFA. So there's a lot of content that, if you're coming from FIFA, is very, very different.
Absolutely. Now, some of what you just said, I've actually already noticed in the demo. First and foremost, the AI of the goal of a keeper. Absolutely. I've noticed. I made a few saves that I don't think I probably would have made on FIFA 14.
Just, well, that's good that you're noticing that. Yeah.
Absolutely. The other thing is the pinpoint passing. Now, you know, I've actually noticed, and I don't know, maybe this could be all in my mind, I've noticed it just when the keeper is actually just giving the ball back out to a teammate, the passing control there seems to be more accurate too. Is that right?
Yeah, that would filter down to the keeper, because, you know, at the end of the day, he's a player on the pitch, and if he's passing, he's no real different from an outfield player. Obviously, his passing ability will probably be less, but at the same time, it's the same kind of dynamic and the same functionality. So any kind of passing improvements we do would translate to the goalkeeper, so it's good that you're noticing that as well.
That's awesome, yeah. And in terms of the more being more responsive, I've actually noticed that too. It's funny because you kind of get used to playing it with the slight, ever so slight hesitation. But when now that's being taken away, it's an adjustment period, because now you're like, okay, I had that move timed this way. Now
right.
I have to kind of adjust to it, responding immediately. But it's still a good thing.
Okay, good. It's good that you're noticing all this stuff. Because, yeah, that's the feedback we've been getting generally, is that people do notice a very difference from FIFA 14. And as I say, that becomes more apparent the more frequently you've played FIFA 14. The difference is really quite noticeable if you've played it recently.
Yeah, now atmosphere is a big thing. So
absolutely.
Most of us have played the demo, and we've noticed a few things as well about that. Can you talk about some of the things that we'll see, or that we already see in the demo, and some of the things that will appear in the full version that are related mostly to World Cup specific atmosphere?
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, that's such a huge part of the World Cup. I mean, at the end of the day, World Cup is football. There's no new rules because it is the World Cup. But what makes it, many people's, myself included, best favourite sporting event in the world is this amazing atmosphere that it generates. And that's, you know, these 32 teams that are participating go to the host nation. So it's much a celebration of culture and humanity almost, and differences between everyone, as it is with football. And the broadcast, if you watch a World Cup broadcast to a regular Premier League broadcast, for example, it's a very different experience because the broadcasters know this is what makes the World Cup special. And consequently, if the ball goes out of play, you know, they'll cut to the crazy fan in the crazy outfit in the crowd, or, you know, the pretty girl in the crowd or whatever it is. And consequently, the broadcast is a very different feel. So obviously, to do the World Cup game justice, we really need to capture that element. So we've got the fully rendered 3D crowd in all their crazy get-up, which will obviously change from country to country. And one thing about the World Cup is that a lot of people kind of go back to stereotypes. So, you know, if you play Sweden, you see the Viking horns and right. That kind of thing. So you'll see that. It's not just the crowd, but it's a unique crowd to whoever you're playing with. And you'll see them react to it, so, you know, you'll see them biting the fingernails in the penalty kick situation, going crazy if they score. So it's not just kind of a stock footage, it's actually emotional, that's tied to actually what's going on in the game. And we've taken that to the next level this time, because one of the things we wanted to get across with the World Cup game is just how massive these games are. Literally, the two teams that are taking part in them, the countries kind of grind to a halt while it's happening. Right. If you go to England and walk around Trafalgar Square while an England match is going on, I guarantee anyone you see there is a tourist, and because all the Brits are in the pubs or at home watching it on TV. And so we recreated that in game by having these fan fests, which is a common, it's actually reasonably recent occurrence. And now what happens is a lot of the nations will set up like big jumbotrons in key parts of the city. So, for example, in Arc de Triomphe in France, or Brandenburg Gate in Germany. So we'll now actually cut to those fan fests, and you'll see the fans standing in these kind of landmark places watching the game up on the screen. And again, they'll react accordingly. So it'll cut back at a goal and you'll see them going crazy, or if it's against them, then they'll be angry and all the rest of it. And that really kind of adds an element of national pride, which is kind of what the World Cup's all about. You know, if you see your landmark, you see the Capitol building, for example, if you're playing as the US, it kind of, you know, gets your blood pumped a little bit. And it really also adds variation. So you'll see these, we've got one of these for every single team in the game. So it just adds variation, because that will change based on who you're playing. So you're not seeing the same thing all over again. It will vary depending on who you're playing. So it kind of mixes things up that way. And like I say, it just really does kind of emphasize the whole global nature of it. Yeah. Over and above that, we've got the managers as well. So we've got the 19 managers. So you'll see them again out on the sidelines. You'll see them if you win the World Cup, lose the World Cup. Again, they're emotionally tied to what you're doing and will react accordingly. And that's the reason for that, is that the managers themselves become such a massive part of the World Cup, more so than players in many respects, because, you know, there's countless press conferences, and they become just kind of celebrities in their own right. So we've got all the major ones in there, you know, we've got Jurgen Klinsmann for the US, Roy Hodgson for England, et cetera, et cetera. So that's another element. And then you've probably noticed the kind of spectacular fly-ins as well at the beginning of the match in the stadiums. Mm-hmm. And that was something we really wanted to capture, because the Brazilians have done an amazing job of creating these stadiums. It was touch and go for a while, but they finished them. And the thing with the stadiums is they're very spectacular looking, but most of the spectacular nature of them is from the outside. Mm-hmm. If you're just playing in-game, you're kind of staring at the pitch, and you're kind of limited in what you can actually see of the stadium, and certainly you can't see the outside. So we really wanted to kind of capture what's special about these stadiums. But so we've done all the external geometry, which we've never done on the 360 PS3 before. And consequently, we can now create these really dramatic fly-ins where it kind of swoops in over the crowd walking into the stadium and over the edge of the stadium. And that really kind of builds up the atmosphere and gives you a sense of occasion. You know, you kind of dive in into this cauldron of excitement and all the rest of it. So it really just part of building up that atmosphere. And then over and above that, the stuff you haven't seen if you've just got the demo. So we've got the radio show, which is really exciting in the front end. So previously, when you return to the front end after a match, you would just kind of listen to the music, which obviously we've got an extensive soundtrack as well. Okay. But we've also now got a radio show, which is optional. You can just listen to the music if you want. But we've actually got two of them. So we've got Andy Goldstein and Ian Dark. And then we've got the Men in Blazers, and you can pick which one you want to listen to. And that really adds a level of immersion that we've never been able to get to before, because they'll be talking about what's going on in the World Cup. They'll be talking about your performance. It's done as a radio show, and they're not talking at you, because that would be a little bit cheesy. But, you know, say if you're playing as the US and you've won your first two games and you only need a draw going into the final game, they'll start discussing that and how the manager sets up differently. Does he play for the draw, et cetera, et cetera. So it really kind of guides you through what's happening in the World Cup, gives you a sense of this much bigger event going on around you, which is obviously key to it. We don't want you to just feel like the center of everything. The World Cup's a massive event. We want you to feel like you're a small part of this big event that's going on around you. And it also really kind of offers the ability to kind of for us to educate people about the World Cup. You know, they'll talk about what makes the World Cup so special. What's your favorite historic moment in all the World Cups? We'll have emails from listeners, virtual listeners, as it were, and they'll answer those and all this kind of thing. So it really kind of creates an atmosphere and a level of immersion that we've never been able to get to before. So that's an exciting new feature. And they're very emotional as well, because they, you know, if you play as US, Men in Blazers are big fans of the US, or if you play as England, you can hear that emotion coming through. And it's also very funny. The guys did an amazing job. There's over 50 hours of content, so you'll hopefully never hear repetition. And it varies from country to country, so we got a lot of unique, specific stuff for the big countries. As I say, that's a kind of really exciting feature. And then we've also got training, which again adds to the atmosphere. So previously, in previous World Cup games, you kind of went game to game to game to game. Now we've interspersed that with training, so you now go game, training, game, training. So that really breaks the flow up, and again, the radio show's going in all around this, so it kind of creates this immersive loop. But what training does, it's great for two reasons. So one, it gives you the opportunity to build up your stats of your players. So previously we've just like given you the US team and you kind of have to go and play with them as they are. Now through the addition of training, you can actually train those guys up. So maybe you think Landon Donovan needs to get a bit pacey. You can pick him, you can pick a pace training drill. We've got new skill drills in there, and you can actually train him up. So it gives you a level of kind of control and influence like never before.
It's almost like a career mode within.
Absolutely. And it's not all too powerful. You know, it is limited. You can only take a few players in each time. So we didn't want to give people the ability to create, you know, these kind of uber players that are all maxed out at 99. And there is kind of a risk and a reward element as well. So if you do terrible at it, you might hit his morale, so actually lower him. So that's really exciting because, like I say, it breaks it up. It gives you the opportunity to influence like never before. And it also teaches you a lot about the game that you might not necessarily know. You know, the skill games were created to kind of teach about elements that it starts off at simplistic, but when you get to the end, it's more advanced stuff. So, you know, things like chip shot or finesse shot. Mm-hmm. Maybe there's a lot of players out there that don't use that functionality. Through skill games and the training, you actually learn about it. So it's this kind of really interesting. It breaks the game up, it adds immersion, it gives you control like never before, and it also teaches you about the game as well. So that's just a few of the things we've done to add to the atmosphere. And as I say, it is the most atmospheric game we've ever made in terms of capturing the essence of the tournament.
You know, I would actually say that I think I can safely say that the mini games, the skill games in FIFA are probably the most relevant to the real actual gameplay of any sports game that I can think of.
That's good.
Yeah. Usually, you know, because like you were saying, you do kind of get an opportunity to be able to use what you've learned in the skill games in actual gameplay. So it does function as practice and training.
Yep.
As opposed to just something kind of one-off, which is pretty cool.
Absolutely.
You made a comment also about the commentating being different for World Cup. Now, I've liked the whole stitching aspect that the FIFA series has used in regards to commentating over the past years. Was there something completely new done with the commentating for this particular version?
If we're talking in-game commentary, obviously the radio show itself is in the menus, and that's entirely new. But in-game, yes. So there was a lot of stuff done. So, I mean, we utilize some of the things we have in FIFA. So, you know, you'll hear them talking about all, they'll introduce the teams every time and talk about the, you know, anthems and all the rest of it. So, and then over and above that, there is a whole bunch of new content that's obviously World Cup specific. So, you know, they'll talk about past World Cups, they'll talk about history and all the rest of it. So, yes, there is a, there's a whole bunch of content that's unique for the World Cup, because obviously it wouldn't be the World Cup game if the commentary didn't reflect that. So you'll hear a lot of things, you know, like I say, talking about the history, talking about the players, talking about what they need to do. So I mentioned that in the radio show. They'll also talk about that in the commentary as well. So, you know, again, if you need a win in the last game of the group stage, they'll talk about that. So it keeps you informed of exactly what's going on. And we'll also have updates from other matches coming in as well, because obviously that's particularly relevant in the World Cup, because you know, if you're in the road to the World Cup, the qualification process, you know, only the top team goes through automatically in most cases. So it's important to know what the other teams are doing. And then once you get to the World Cup itself, obviously that last game of the group stage, often things aren't tied up by then. It's about the game you're in and the game that's taking place at exactly the same time as yours. So that creates a level of drama. So obviously, you know, you might have gone one behind, but then the other team has also dropped, is also losing, so you're still going through. So you'll get comments relating to that, of what's actually happening in the other games as well. Again, adding to the immersion and drama of the whole thing.
That's really cool. Now, will you talk a little bit about it, but can you kind of break down each of the different game modes that will be available in the full version?
Sure. I mean, there's a lot, so I'll have to fly through these. But yeah, I mean, obviously, first and foremost is the World Cup tournament itself. And you can actually jump to the part in Brazil, which is the kind of, we call the World Cup finals. It's completely optional. It defaults to the real world, fixtures, but you can add any teams in there. You know, we've given complete control. Maybe your team didn't make it, so you want to put those in. Then over and above that, we've got the road to the World Cup. So if you're only kind of a casual football fan, you might not realize that the World Cup itself is actually a much bigger tournament than just the part that takes place in Brazil.
Right.
It involves every single team on the planet, and we have every single team on the planet in the game for the first time. And it takes 2 years. So we've got all that road to the World Cup, and that actually varies. It's a very different experience depending on the region you're in. So it's split over five regions, I think it is. So for example, in Europe, the qualification process is just kind of a standard league between you and a bunch of other teams. But then if you go to CONCACAF, for example, it becomes much more complicated, because, you know, there's a league, then you have the hex and all this kind of a crazy qualification process. So it's almost five games in one, in that if you pick a different team from each of the confederations, that experience will be very different. And you even have intercontinental playoffs in some of them, like Oceania will play the fifth place group in South America, or whichever one it is. So it is a very different experience. So we've got all that. We've then also got story of qualifying. So that's a challenge-based mode, and that replicates events that took place in the road to the World Cup, in the real world. So, for example, maybe it's the U.S.'s now infamous game against Costa Rica that was played in those crazy blizzard conditions.
Yeah.
So we've got those for all the teams in the world as well, all the different confederations. So, and we throw you in there at not necessarily the kickoff. It can be, you know, the 50th minute. It can be the 89th minute. You could be 3-0 down, you could be 3-0 up, so it really kind of mixes it up. And that mode really kind of offers us an opportunity to really, again, showcase just how big the World Cup is. Because maybe as a US fan, you might just go in and take the US to the World Cup. If you play story qualifying, we make you play with teams you might not necessarily pick. So you see all the effort we do in creating that, all the different stadiums as well. So, you know, if you play away in Afghanistan, you'll see this, a stadium that kind of represents that region. So it really kind of showcases the World Cup as a global event. We have Captain Your Country, which is a really cool mode. I don't know if you played the 2010 version, but it kind of debuted in that.
Mm-hmm.
We've brought that back. Well, we've brought a lot more stuff around it. So that the idea of that mode is you create yourself, or you pick a normal player, and you start out in the lower echelons of the manager's eyes, as it were, on the low in the rankings. If you're picking a professional player, we bill it that he's coming back from injury, because obviously it wouldn't make sense if Donovan was in the reserves.
Right.
But then you start on the lower echelons, and then you play B team matches, which is kind of the reserves, and the idea is that you, through playing well, because you get a man of the match rating at the end of each game, you work your way up this list, and the idea is that ultimately you get picked for, you know, friendlies, then in the actual internationals, with a view to getting into the World Cup squad. And the overall goal of the mode is to be picked as captain and see yourself lift the World Cup trophy in the Maracanã in the World Cup. The interesting thing about this mode is that you're just playing as an individual. It's a multiplayer mode, four players local. If you don't have four mates, then you're just up against the CPU, three mates, should I say. But it really comes into its own when you do play with friends, because it creates this interesting dynamic in that you're all in it for the same ultimate goal, so maybe taking the US to the World Cup final. But at the same time, your friends are also your direct competitors. So you're playing as an individual, so maybe you're in the game, you're to clean through on goal, the obvious ball would be to your teammate who's just, you know, to the left of you or whatever for a simple tap-in. But you might think, well, actually, maybe I don't want to do that, because if I do that, he's going to get a better rating than me, and maybe then he becomes the captain. So it creates this interesting dynamic and a lot of colourful language if you do play with your friends on occasion. So that's a really exciting mode that you can't actually get anywhere else other than the World Cup game. We then have the brand new skill games.
Kind of like a Rooney Van Persie dynamic.
Exactly. Yes, exactly. This isn't unique to the virtual world. We know that this happens in the regular, in real world, so it's creating a little bit of that tension, shall we say. So then we've got the skill games, so we've got some all new skill games as well. And then online was a big area for us, because obviously, as we all know, the online experience is a lot more fun beating a human than it is the AI. So we've got the online World Cup, so that's the ability to play through the group stage and the knockout stages and win the World Cup final. Obviously, that's quite a daunting mode, because you're up against other users, and by the time you win it, you've kind of basically won. You got out of the group stage, and then you've won four consecutive online games, which can be a little tough. So we've kind of given mini goals, so it's not just all about winning the World Cup. So if you pick a team, you'll see the community average with that team. So instantly there's a kind of sub-goal, can I become a better than the community player with, you know, Afghanistan or whoever it is you pick to go into. There's also, it shows your own personal best. So obviously that's a carrot dangled in front of you to beat. You know, maybe your personal guess is best is just the quarterfinals. Instantly this becomes about beating that. We also compare you to your friends as well. So obviously friendly rivalry kind of drives the competition. So, you know, if you've got 10 friends, we'll show you their personal best and how far they've got with that team. So it's not just about winning the World Cup. It's this kind of sub goals. We've again got Road to Rio de Janeiro, which is a very cool mode, and that's really showcases Brazil as a venue. And it's kind of based loosely on the seasons mode in FIFA, if you've played that one.
Yes.
And the idea is that there's 12 divisions. Each division is represented by an official stadium. And you start off in Manaus, up in the Amazon jungle. And the idea is that you have to get promotion out of each division, and the promotion changes as you move along. So for the first one, it's quite easy. It's something like 10 points in 10 games. So consequently, this is a lot more forgiving in that you can lose a whole bunch and you don't have to go back to the start. You know, in that instance, you could lose six and then win the last four and you get through. And then as you progress, you unlock content about the cities, city artwork, details about the city. And the idea is that you're moving along this map, and you see this as you're playing the mode, with the ultimate goal of reaching the Maracanã in Rio. And if you win that division, you see yourself lift the World Cup. So again, that's against all online users. You can take any team in the whole game in there. So, you know, you can finish it as the Brazil, Spain, then maybe challenge yourself a little more, or, you know, go in as Costa Rica or someone like that.
Okay.
So that's a really cool mode. We've also got online friendlies, which was interesting in that we have no plans to actually include this, but this was actually driven directly by community feedback. So we put that one in, and that's basically the ability to hook up directly with one of your friends and play a mini tournament against them.
Oh yeah, definitely.
That was in FIFA. It was taken out, and then such was the kind of vocal support for the feature on the community, on the forums, we actually brought that back in. So I mean, that's kind of a whirlwind tour. We've got a few more as well, but that's probably the majority. Oh, story of finals, I should mention as well. So that's kind of like story of qualifying, except that's linked to the live tournament. So that this mode doesn't actually unlock until they kick off the real world tournament in Brazil. And the idea with that is we have a challenge for every single game that gets played in the real world. And that is based on what happens. So we really want to capture that kind of emotion and excitement of what you've just witnessed in the real world, and then take all that excitement, energy and adrenaline and come to our game about an hour after you've watched it and relive it. We want to make our game kind of the go-to place after the real world event. And again, similarly with story qualifying, we can throw you in any situation. So maybe Donovan scores a hat-trick in the last 10 minutes. That challenge will be you playing as Donovan with 10 minutes to go, seeing if you can recreate it. And one of the interesting things this time around, we'll actually be storing every single one of those challenges. So by the time you get to the World Cup final, you've got a challenge for every single game that was played in the real world. So it almost becomes kind of this scrapbook or memoir of what the actual tournament took place, because you're able to look back and say, oh yeah, USA beat Ghana 3-0. Let me go and try and recreate that. Right. So that's a live link to the real world, which is very cool as well. And we've also got the match day stats as well. So that's real world form that will be reflected in the game. So we have our guys monitoring who's playing well and all the rest of it. So if you turn that feature on, and you can turn it on in the online modes as well, the players will be reflected accordingly. So, you know, if Ronaldo goes on a tear and scores the hat trick and is playing the best football in his life, you'll see that reflected in our game as well. So it's the most connected game we've ever had as well.
Oh, cool. And how quickly will those updates take place?
Yeah, we're aiming for about an hour.
Okay, great, great. Now, what would you say is your favorite aspect of this particular version of the game?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a sum of many parts. I think it is what you kind of alluded to earlier. I think it's the atmosphere package that I think we've really done. And I include in that, you know, the radio show, all the stuff we've done in the back end, the training feature, just the kind of core loop of playing the tournament is the most kind of involved and atmospheric that we've ever done. You know, we set out to make something very different in terms of that core experience. So previously, you know, the experience was just, I mean, it was good, but the experience was just kind of game to game to game to game. Now, like I say, we've got game training. And whilst you're in the front end, you've got this immersive radio show going on, and then you get to the back end and you get all the commentary and the effects and all that. So I think it's just kind of the sense of occasion and the sense of atmosphere that we've generated in the World Cup this time. I think that's probably my favorite kind of piece, even though it's a very big piece.
Absolutely. Now, just had two more questions for you. Now, was there much added graphically? Because I could have just been like excited to play, but it felt as though to me that the player models, they popped a little bit more. I like a little crazy, or is that accurate?
No, and we've done a lot. So we've done a lot of work on the look of it. And yes, I'm glad you see that as well. So I mean, from things like the externals. Part of the stadium, all that kind of stuff. The crowd, I mean, that's a lot of new content that's in there. But yes, we've completely redone all the lighting. Well, I say redone, we've done it from the ground up for the Brazilian stadiums. And then the heads as well, so we've added a lot of player heads. If you're playing as the US, we actually got access, because we work closely with the US, we have good partnership with those guys. So we actually got access to that team when they played Mexico in Columbus a few months back. So we took our rig down there, our mocap rig, and captured the player heads. So for the first time ever, we've got fully authentic US team. So if you're playing as the US, that's perhaps why you're seeing that as well. But yes, absolutely, we do a lot of work for every title on the visuals, and we're continually pushing them. And I think we probably pushed the PS3 and the Xbox as far as we can go on this, to the point that when we released some of the images, people were actually saying it was next gen. So it was good to get that feedback.
Yeah, that's definitely a good thing. I know that probably looking forward, you know, the game will be on there, on next gen. So would you say that some of these concepts, and this is the last question I got for you, would you say that some or all of the concepts that have been introduced in FIFA World Cup, some of the new stuff, is that going to be present in FIFA games moving forward, or will some of it or all of it be kept solely for World Cup games?
No, I mean, the idea is that we kind of continually improve on things. You know, we take the gameplay engine and we build on that, and then FIFA will take that, et cetera, et cetera. So the idea is that everything we do would kind of feed into the next games. I mean, the caveat to that is obviously we'd monitor consumer feedback, forums. Some things just won't make sense to take it on into future iterations, you know, all the kind of specifically Brazilian things. Mm-hmm. Obviously, it's very unique to Brazil as a venue. But other than that, yeah, the expectation is that we'll take things that people like and move the other games forward with those. So we'll see. But the intention is. And one thing I should just mention, particularly for the kind of casual gamer, if someone's listening to this and they've previously picked up FIFA and maybe not found it a little bit too complicated because they may be a casual football fan and they haven't played sport games as well. One of the other things we have added, we've specifically focused on casuals because we know the World Cup, the appeal of the World Cup. There's a lot of people drawn to it because it comes around every 4 years. You don't have to be
thing.
In. It is, and you don't have to be into club football to appreciate it. Everyone's from a country, so instantly everyone's got someone to cheer for. And as I mentioned, we've got every single team in the world, so there's a team for everyone in this game. So we want to make sure we kind of captured that appeal of the casual. So we've got a brand new difficulty level in there called Beginner, which if you're a returning FIFA user, you'll never see because it'll default to your existing level. And really, for FIFA aficionados, they shouldn't go anywhere near it because they'll find it offensively easy, to be honest. But it is a mode specifically designed for anyone that's really never picked up FIFA. It's a mode that's really designed to let people kind of experience the fun and rewarding nature of, scoring and celebrating and all that kind of stuff. The intention is that, or the expectation is that, people will find their feet on that and then move up the skill levels to find the one that they kind of find challenging. But it is a mode that's specifically designed. So if you've never ever played FIFA, you're wondering why everyone thinks it's the best sports game there is out there, and the World Cup is the best opportunity to kind of get on the bandwagon, as it were. So if you've previously been put off or you've tried it and you thought it was too complex, this is the game to kind of get and get into FIFA.
Sure. Yeah, and part of the reason why I asked some of the questions that I asked is because I think the perception out there is that this is a kind of like some people may think it's like a novelty game and not a full game, a fully featured game. But in actuality, it looks as though it's much more than a full featured game, and it's also meant to be a rather important piece in the entire FIFA series.
Absolutely, and that's one of the key things. We are a full we are a full package good, so we want to make people feel that there's enough content, and there is. There's 10 game modes, like I say, every team in the world, every player in the world that plays for the national squad. So there's an absolute mountain of content in there, and the reason for that is World Cup's interesting, and it's about 50-50 in terms of who buys it. So about 50% are returning FIFA users. And about 50% have never picked up FIFA before, or this is the only FIFA game they buy, and they buy it once every 4 years. So for those guys, it's important that it is treated like a standalone good, because if you're coming to it and you don't buy FIFA, there's no expectation of what FIFA is and all the rest of it. So we want to make sure there's modes and content that if this is the only football game you buy, you have plenty to keep you going. And to be honest, the World Cup is a massive event, and we want to do it justice. And to do it justice, we've really got to really have a lot of game modes, a lot of content, because it is such a big tournament, not just the bit in Brazil, like I say, but the qualification process. So for that reason, it's a hugely important game, because like I say, a lot of people, this is the only game they buy. So we've got to think, if this is the only game they buy, we've got to make it as good and as big as we possibly can. So there is a lot of content in there as a consequence of that.
Absolutely. Well, Matt, I appreciate your time. I think we got a lot of great information to share in regards to FIFA World Cup. Can you tell us again, for those that don't know, what day it releases in terms of the full version?
Yep. So it would release April 15th, which is a Tuesday.
Which is tomorrow.
Which is tomorrow, absolutely.
Right.
So, yes, it's almost upon us.
Yes, sir. All right, so that is great to know, man. And like I said, thanks again for your time. And we look forward to getting our hands on a full copy of FIFA World Cup.
You're welcome. I'm always happy to talk about the game. It was great fun to make it, so hopefully a lot of people will enjoy it. I know they will.
Yeah.